speak Jesus.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus.
Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the
Seasons will change, colors will fade, but I know that you remain. If the road changes course, my compass, your voice, and you will not leave me somewhere you
Good morning, Grace Church. Can you hear me okay? Good to see you guys this morning. I've got a few announcements I'm going to go over right here. And they're also, they should be, well, okay, I don't see any on the, but there should be some in the back. But anyway, I will announce them. So let me announce the offering real quick. You know, we don't pass around the buckets anymore. We have the two black boxes in the back. If you want to put your offering in there, you can go to our website, www.gracehp.org, and click on the I Give button. Or you can text any dollar amount to 84321. And again, like I said, we've got the black boxes in the back. So we've got an upcoming event for the youth. Mike Weaver, who's not here right now, but he and I and my and possibly his wife and anybody else are planning on going to take the youth to see for King and Country at the Greensboro Coliseum. And it is on the 11th, Sunday the 11th of December. So if you're interested in that for your youth, and then any parents that would like to come are welcome to come as well with their youth, please come and see me so that we can get your names down. And then we can work out the ticket sales and all that stuff, all right? I'm going to turn it over to my lovely wife here.
So, you know, I'm always good for a five-year-old Morgan story. So the other day I pick her up from daycare, and she was like, "Mom, it's Wednesday." I'm like, "Yeah." She's like, "Well, what's next Wednesday?" I was like, "Nothing, it's Wednesday." She goes, "Next Wednesday is going to be the best Wednesday ever." I'm like, "Okay." She has no clue what next Wednesday is or what it brings, but it's still, to her, going to be the best Wednesday ever. So I think we kind of need to remember that, like as we're going into our weeks, that we don't know what the next day brings or the next week or the next month, but it's still going to be the best day ever because it's the day that God gave us. So with that, we're going to turn it over.
We're going to pray real
quick. And pray. Johnny's going to pray.
I'm going to pray. So I'm going to do a little Morgan thing too. She was at our house. She was at the house, and we were eating lunch, and Morgan likes to drink these things, and Laura kind of got us all drinking these things called, it's like sparkling water, right? So it's just seltzer water. So it's just water with a little bit of fizz and a little bit of flavor. And so Morgan wanted one, and it was the last one, and Laura had popped it open, right? And so she popped it open, and Morgan goes, and she goes, "Well, you just take this one, Morgan, because this is the last one." So Morgan grabbed it, and Morgan's a five-year-old girl, like you said. And she goes, she stuck her finger in it to see how much of it was drank. And she goes to her mom, she goes, "Dang, girl, you drank a lot." And so it was just the funniest thing I ever heard from her lately. So anyway, hey, let's get ready to worship God. Let's stand up. And let's pray for this, and let's invite the presence of God and the Holy Spirit and Jesus to come down and be worshiped by us. Father, we love you. We love you in this place. We welcome you in this place, Lord God. Be enthroned in this place. Be magnified in this place. Be loved in this place. Feel it all from us, Lord God. This sacrifice to you that we're here to give you freely and joyfully. And we're excited about that. Be excited about that. To be able to praise, the living God who saved all of our souls and lives in us and lives to intercede for us daily. That's something to be excited about, isn't it? Every day, we are blessed. We may not feel it right now, but we are blessed. So be blessed, Lord God, by us today in Jesus' name. Let's worship.
How you guys doing? So today we got something a little different. Our drummer came down with the flu at the last minute. So, but we don't need that to worship, right? But we do need some rhythm. So may I introduce to you DJ Kayleanne. She's gonna be DJing the drums today. So pray for us that it goes well. But let's just begin to worship. And also, let's pray for Joshua that flu would be taken off of him immediately, that it would not spread to the rest of the family, Lord, but that whole household would just experience your good, your great health. So come, Holy Spirit, come into this room. Come, Holy Spirit. Come on, let's release our voices to the Lord. There's a mighty river flowing. There's a mighty river flowing in this place. And there's a mighty river flowing. There's a mighty river flowing
through this place.
Let's jump.
from the moment of rescue. I am never.
put our hands together.
Bye. stepped into my grave, laughing at the guilt and shame, and all my fears were stripped away. Now I stand and sing. I am washed by the blood of the Lamb. I am washed by the blood of the Lamb. And by your scars, my sin. Thank you.
blood of the Lamb, and by your scars, my sin erased, our medicine. I am washed by the blood of the Lamb. I am washed by the blood of the Lamb, and by your stripes I'm closer than I've ever been. Thank you.
just right where you are, to just kind of reach out to someone, you know. Don't overdo it or anything like that. Just reach out to someone. Just begin to bless them. Just begin to get that flow of the Holy Spirit going. Yeah? Be a husband or wife, a good friend, maybe somebody you don't even know. Just put a hand on the shoulder, not on the head. Just release blessing. Blessing, blessing, blessing. This morning, yeah. Thank you, Lord. Sometimes you kind of got to jumpstart things by kind of turning to someone else and just beginning to minister. Simple blessing. Yeah. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you. It was Bob Jones, I think, that used to say all the time, said, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Can we say so this morning that we're redeemed? Can we do that? Yeah, that feels good. And I also want to get, when we sing a song like Bag of Bones, which happens to me be my granddaughter's favorite song, at the end of that song, I'll give you permission to yell, clap, shout, do nothing. Be free in the house. But sometimes we need to celebrate the songs that we're singing. What's that, Marsha? Hell lost another. Lost me. Yeah. I am free. I am free. Yeah. Well, I've got something to report this morning. Many of you know that I've been asking people, because I lost my wallet on the way to the Outer Banks week before last, I think. Do what? A few days before, I couldn't find it. So I drove anyway, which I'm not supposed to do. I always got behind cars that was going a little bit faster than everybody else, just so I'd be okay. I confess it, Lord. I prayed for that. I prayed, I prayed, I prayed. I prayed for that wallet. I prayed. I was with a prophetic group Thursday night, and I said, all right, I couldn't wait to get here because I want to hear you tell me where my lost wallet is. I didn't get much response. Got one. And so, here it is, guys. Yeah. Here it is. Now, here's the cool thing about this. It was in the side pocket of our car. I guarantee you, at least a dozen times, I opened that door, took everything out, ran my hand through it, and there was nothing there. Absolutely. And not only, now wait a minute, you know me, men sometimes can look in the refrigerator looking right at the mustard and not see it. We know that. We have to ask our wives where it is. So Marsha looked. She ran her hand all the way through that thing. And under the seats and everywhere else. And this morning, it was laying in plain sight, in the side pocket. What do you think? I think that can't be explained naturally. Somebody put it there. Somebody. Hallelujah. That's big. I kept checking my accounts and credit cards and bank statements, and nothing was ever taken out of it. I said, we stopped at Chick-fil-A. I called Chick-fil-A. I said, you have my wallet? You know, it was just, I mean, I'm celebrating this morning. I really am. I'm thanking God. That was an angel, guys. Had to be an angel. There's no other explanation for that. None, because I was, anyway. You want to hear another testimony? Yeah. Come on, John. How many of you enjoyed having the House of Prayer and Tom and all the testimonies last week? Wasn't that awesome? You remember John's testimony last week? He might want to remind you, but I'm going to let him testify again. This is amazing too.
Thank you, Rodney. Some of y'all might have heard my testimony last week, but Pastor Rodney has given me the opportunity just to spread the good news that the Lord did for me this week. And I think the best way to just go ahead and deliver this is just tell you the whole situation and how it went down. But I was at the thrift, and I was in the furniture room, and I was back. I had Eddie and Matt with me, and I was tagging. And I've had some issues at the thrift. I'm not going to talk about it, but there's just been a few things going on. And all of a sudden, this guy walks up, and he's just in his black. He's got all black on, his biker stuff, and he's got a helmet on. And he's standing from where me and Johnny is, and he's just staring at me. And so I just kind of, I'm not going to lie, I was a little nervous. The guy just stares at me, and I just stare back at him. I'm smiling, and I said, can I help you? And the guy just looks at me and does the head tilt. If he didn't do the head tilt, I would have been all right. But he just looks at me and does this little head tilt, and then he goes, I want to speak to the manager. And it was, I couldn't understand the guy's voice because he still had his helmet on. And I don't remember too much because I was super nervous. And I said, I'm right here. Like that. And all of a sudden, he just started coming towards me real fast. And as he's coming towards me real fast, he rips his helmet off. And it was my brother. Yeah. So I'm just really thankful that I was able to do my testimony here last week, because it got back to my brother, and he rode all the way down here in 30 degrees, 20 degree weather on a bike and stayed outside. I asked him where he slept. He said, I slept outside last night to come and see me. And I just want to thank y'all. I tell you what, if I could choose $1 million or see my brother again, I'm taking my brother any day. And it's just apparently he saw it, and God is so good to me. It's like I just keep thinking about, like, you know, I got a verse in Ecclesiastes about how everything underneath the sun has hope. And that's just so true, because if y'all knew me then, I never thought I had hope. And he just proves me wrong every single day. So the one moment I wish I had Johnny B's with me, that it would totally would have backfired on my brother. But I want to just thank you, Grace, for letting me tell y'all about that, all right?
Isn't that great? So I'm going to move from the handheld. Good. I'm still with you, huh? Tom told me that his brother actually saw him on our YouTube broadcast in here. And pretty cool, huh? Yeah. I could give you another testimony. You want another one or you want? And I'm doing this for a reason, because I feel like the Lord's building faith for the supernatural among us. This church was birthed in the supernatural move of the Spirit. It's been revived from time to time in the Spirit, in the supernatural Spirit. And we're getting ready to go into a realm of the Holy Spirit that we've never experienced before. Okay? All right. I'm a real stickler for credibility. So when I have a testimony, especially about a miracle or healing, I research it out, who says it, who tells it, to make sure it's the real deal. So this is a book called Miracles Today by Craig Keener. Craig is a professor at Asbury Theological. He's well respected across all circles, evangelical circle as well as in the charismatic movement. Randy has him some. And here's an eyewitness account. I'll just read it to you. Came out of Suriname. Suriname is a multicultural nation in South America whose national language is Dutch. Although many people in Suriname have long been Christians, one popular group in Nikiri, Suriname, had another dominant faith and resisted the Christian message for centuries. Centuries. Nobody could penetrate that other faith, or what they believe. For generations, only a few hundred Christians lived there, and churches competed with each other for the same members. Kind of like the United States, isn't it? When I met Dr. Douglas Norwood in 2006, he shared with me his eyewitness experience from 12 years before. Also recounted in his dissertation. He wrote a dissertation on it, or part of it. He was a Moravian pastor, and Moravians have been among the pioneers of churches there. In November 1994, after he preached, the churches there repented of their divisions and cried out to God for an outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Believe, we're going to do that in January. Believers went out and began to share their faith with surprised neighbors who had never known the Christians to act this way before. That night, many non-Christians gathered at the church. A few of them were hostile. One hostile visitor, perhaps in his 70s, had been paralyzed on his right side virtually all his life. Because he could not walk, his friends had brought him on a blanket or rug and plopped him down on the ground in front of Norwood. This man was not happy. "Your religion is garbage," he said. He shouted it. "My religion is garbage too. I prayed to Shiva, to Vishnu, and to my other gods, and nothing happens. Now you want me to pray to Jesus?" If you know who Vishnu and Shiva is, that those are Indian idols and Indian gods. "Now you want me to pray to Jesus?" he said scornfully. As he uttered the name of Jesus, his paralyzed arm suddenly shot up into the air. He stared at his own arm, shocked. No one had prayed for him, but when he mentioned Jesus, God healed his paralysis. Norwood reports, "At that instance, he jumped up, grabbed my mic, and began screaming, 'Look what Jesus did for me. Look what Jesus did for me.' As he danced around, waving his now healed arm in the air. The other visitors were converted almost as quickly as he was. Wow. It's not the whole story. It never is. This was the beginning of a movement that over the next few years brought tens of thousands of people to faith in Jesus, most of whom had previously little exposure to Jesus. The massive growth of the Christian movement in Suriname, Nicaragua, Suriname, in recent decades is a well-known fact. We got to get ready. Got to get ready. I don't know what to do this morning. Keep going, Marcia, huh? Okay. Pumped. Wasn't when I walked in, but I am now. Especially when I saw that wallet. You want to give an offering? Did we cover that? Okay. Give for, like I say, give for the kingdom. Give for yourself. Give for your family. Give for your future. I'm a living witness of the faithfulness of God. All right. Now, some of you have heard this before. Just a few of you. Not everyone. But it bears repeating. I'm going to do it again. Yeah, but I'm going to add some stuff to it from those of you that heard it before. We're gonna talk about weights. So I'm going to read the scriptures out of the New Living Testament, Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. Are you ready? You want to read it together? Let's read it together. I like that. This is the New Living Testament. Remember that. It might be different. Ready? Go. Therefore, okay, good. It's a good word right there. Yeah. Now, we all have a race. We all have a race. There are things that trip us up and things that slow us down. This is what this is addressing. Today, I'm not focusing on the sin part. Holy Spirit's really good at that. What I want to talk about are the weights. The weights, not the sin. Yeah. So part of this is of sharing how I came to this, and I shared this at a leadership time. Part of this is out of testimony, my own testimony, because God's speaking this to me. Especially strongly to me. He's saying to me over and over, over and over and over again, get yourself ready. Get yourself ready. Now, I've said this again, and I'll say it again and again and again. Everything I believe right now is about preparation. It's about what's coming. Isaiah 60 says there's going to be a growing darkness. But also, there's going to be an emerging glory on the church. And we have to deal with that. And we're going to be busy. And right now is a good time to lighten up and get rid of some weights that affect us. Because God is getting ready to light us up. And we want every encumbrance that we know about, that he shows us, not that we try to dream up or think up or in what he shows us, we need to let it go. Let it go. So first is the race. Now the race, Here, I'm not talking about our salvation. We don't run for that. That's a gift. We don't earn that. That's free for us. We were not in that race. That was a race Jesus ran for us. And he finished that race. And there was a joy before him. And that joy was two things. One thing is he pleased the Father because he completed his mission. And the second thing was that we are very joy that he was seeing when he was on that cross. Amen. We were. He came for us. He came for us. Now, this race, Greek, it's a contest. It's a contest not without obstacles or conflict, and not without prizes, and not without promotions. It's a metaphor for our life on earth in Jesus and moving forward in the things of the Lord. One of the most important words I got from my friend Marshall that served me so well for over 20 years, and he knows a lot of stuff and a lot of obstacles and conflicts that I've had to go for. He kept telling me, just keep moving forward. Just keep moving forward. And that's the race. We keep moving forward, whatever obstacle it is. Now, in the race, it helps for us to know God's unique purpose for us. That's part of the race. It's a big part of the race. How can we run if we don't know what his unique purpose is for us? And he will show us that. He will not withhold that. Because we're born with purpose. When we realize our purpose, it puts a resolve down in us to keep us in the right path, in the right lane, and keeps us in the race. Very important. And if you don't know that, I suggest that you just go before the Lord and begin asking. Just begin. You might get a portion of it. You might get a long vision of it. He might suddenly have a dream in your heart. But it's really, really important that you know so that you can run. Because when you hit the obstacles and you have the conflict, you step back into Jesus and into purpose and you keep going. You don't stop. Now, it says here that Jesus is the author and the finisher of our faith somewhere. And I think it's Charles Spurgeon that said that Jesus is with us at the start of the race and he stays with us to the end of it. He never separates himself in that whole thing. So we need to remember this. There is always, listen to this. This is important. Really important for some people that are in here. There is always, always, always grace and power to run the race. And there's always, always, always mercy to get back into the race when you've been out of it. Like Tom said last week, it's not bad to go for it for a second or a third or a fourth time. Because you're always covered in mercy to get back in. Now, I'll tell you a testimony a lot of you have heard. I'm going to say it because not all of you have heard this. When I had a heart attack in March of 21, I believe, it was quite an event for me. It began when I was being given an EKG down where you enter into the ER. And the girl running the EKG, the ECG, whatever it is, he pulled the paper out, and she looked at it, and I was laying up looking at her. So, and she said, I've never seen anything like this before. I knew I was in trouble. I knew I was in trouble. And I was at that point absolutely convinced that it was over for me. Finished. I've run my race. I've kept the course. I've had a heart attack. I need to go somewhere and hide. Go to the beach. Go back to Texas. I don't know. And so I got over it because God actually healed me, and I have a fully functioning heart right now, although every once in a while it kind of jumps around a little bit. Not much. Only when there's stress. And I know that God has spoken with me so many times about, I'm going to satisfy you with a long life. And I've got good genetics. I do. I was with Rodney Robbins last night. Rodney's watching right now. And he said, I can't believe you're 77. I'll show you. I am, but I don't look it, and I don't feel it. I really feel like somebody, like I'm 50. Seriously. I'm not just pumping you or blowing smoke here. So just here recently, I fell back into that mindset. It's over. It's amazing how that spirit can come back on you. And you get convinced, okay, well, it's really time to make some plans, Marcia. We need to figure out where I'm going to be buried or where I'm going to be poured out somewhere. And really begin to think that way. And got down and said, I've done all I can do. I need to get out. You know? Are you with me, guys? So I was in that kind of a mindset for a couple of weeks, and I came in one week, I think it was a Thursday, before we went to the beach, and maybe a couple of weeks, I can't remember what it was. But anyway, I was up in the loft there, secretly spying on Allison, who was down here cleaning. Just making sure she was doing the right job. Making sure she did. She always does. She always does. But I just love to watch her, love to watch her dog. And started a conversation with her, and she said, you know, I got a prophetic word for you. And she had got the word before I even came to the church. And I said, okay, I always want that. What is your word? And she said, the Lord told me that you need to stop thinking about dying and start thinking about living. Yeah. Is that a word? Now, I flipped right that point, just like that, from an old 77 to a young 77. Come on. I went home and I said, we're going to run again. Yeah, I mean, it flipped me. Prophetic words are so vitally important for each other. And we need to grow in that and have a sensitivity to when we need to speak to someone, because you never know what's going on inside someone's heart, but a prophetic word has a way of cutting right through all the stuff, right to the core issue, and speaks into it a word of the Lord. And it always either sets you free or get you moving forward again. Amen? He will pursue you because there's a dedicated plan and purpose for your life. It's pre-planned by God. Your race is pre-planned by God. Any conflict or any obstacle that meets you in your race, in God, the only thing it can do is strengthen you. That's the only thing. Unless you bail. Unless you run. And then you have to run somewhere else. But the gate is always open to come back in. Yeah? What's a song? He never stops working. Even when I don't see it, he's working. That was part of Allison's word to me. She gave me a song. Remember this. He, Jesus, he's cheering us on. He's not assessing our talent in those times or checking out our worthiness. He is cheering us to run the race that's set before us. I think that's a good word. So I said all that to say this. Let us strip off every weight that slows us down. Not talking about sin. Talking about weights that slow us down. I know I'm pressing this whole thing about preparation. I know I'm talking about something that's not yet. Sometimes it seems far off. This morning it seemed a little far off. But I have a personal urgency to get ready. Because God's events many times are suddenlies. Now, we're in the midst of political storms, social chaos, gender confusion, corruption is commonplace, darkness is getting darker, but I promise you, as clear as an angel put that wallet back in my car, there's a presence and glory that's coming upon his church. I don't care if you believe it or not. Because your belief is not going to stop it. It's something that God has determined. So we need to strip off every weight. Listen, I got a list of weights. You want to hear them? You sure about that? All right. Here's it. Let me preface it with this. Our choices are not always about right or wrong, but between something that may hinder us and something that would not. You got that? It's not always about right. Choice is not always about right and wrong. It's about what is good, what could be good, or what would hinder us, and what's best. Now, I want to just, it's a disclaimer. I'm not messing with you this morning. I'm not meddling in your family stuff, in your business. I'm just submitting these things that there may be an issue, as they were for me. Number one, said it already. There's a personal will and plan of God for us. It's a personal will and plan of God for each of us. And in that, some things we have choices then that are okay for others, but it's not good for us. It depends on the race he's put before us and what his unique purpose and his will is for us. So we don't need to get upset when others have this kind of freedom that they can be free in and I can't. And it's because of what God wants. I can't go to some places that others can. I don't look to other people's permissions for me. I look for God's permissions. It's all about following Jesus. What is not a wait for some could be a wait for me. Am I boring you guys to death? I'm just checking. Two, there's a weights of culture. Kathleen Dillard, she had a strong word on this here. I can't remember if she gave it to Marcia and I or she publicly said it. She said, you know, Israel had a problem with this. It was a recurring issue for Israel. They took on the habits of the culture that was around them. Kept getting in trouble with God, you know. When they were called to be distinct and a witness to the culture, instead, Israel assumed the culture and became like the culture around them. We have to watch for that. See, some things blur the lines and drag us down. We have to be discerning about that because we get it in our face all the time. We get it in our face all the time. I think John David was saying, he shared a great message recently in a leadership situation, and he said, you know how many times we see an advertisement or advert a day? And he cited a Market Watch, I believe it was, John David? Yes, no, maybe. I think it's a secular company that measured this. And they came up with most individuals see over 4,000 advertisements a day. It's hard to believe, isn't it? In some form or another, highway signs, YouTube, no tube. You just over and over, it's over and over. So we need to make sure that we're not taking those weights on. They weigh us down. Number three, I'm meddling. There's my mom. My mom. My mom had a gift shop. She had a jewelry store. She had other stores. She's a businesswoman. She had a house full of stuff, a closet full of stuff, an attic full of stuff. Nice stuff. Some of it is super expensive stuff. She passed away. Marcia and I went out to help clean out the house, and we hauled a lot of it back here to our house. Now, we have a house full, a closet full, and an attic full. So what she prized has become a real burden or a weight on us. How do we get rid of this stuff? Two things here. And I'm talking about being ready and getting ready. There are times we need to declutter our lives so we can run with Jesus. some of the things we inherit from our family weigh us down. It's not just things. It's ideas. It's mindsets. It's traditions. It's expectations from our family. And we inherit them, and they become weights. And they're not intended to be. So we need to assess that. What was prized for them can be by others can be a weight for us. Yeah. Are you still with me? Please say yes. Number four, another weight. And these are random, pretty much. Words that are spoken to us that cast doubt of God's love for us can become a weight. Those words can come from friends. They can come from extended family. They can come from a spirit through somebody. What do? We don't let it take root. We judge the fruit. What is that word producing in me? What is it doing? Is it Jesus? Is it love? Is it grace? Is it mercy? Is it loving kindness? Is it gentle? Or is it producing in me? Is it demeaning me? Or is it shaking my security? What is that word producing in me? And if we receive it and let it take root in us, it becomes a weight. And that word can even be not a curse or a bad word. It can be something that doesn't line up with the race that we have been given in Jesus. Come on, I'm getting serious. I'm meddling now. I know it's good. I live this stuff. Sometimes we just need to get it cut off. Cut it. And the quicker you cut it, the better it is. Number five. I'm drawing to a close. Sometimes when we get stuck in the past, we start missing the present presence of God. It can be a weight. I've got a reoccurring dream that I have from time to time. I just had it again. And in the dream, I'm getting ready to speak. And there's a lot of high-profile people there that are nationally known that's going to be listening to me. And it's a platform that I've never been on before to share. And I'm not happy about that. And I don't have a word. And I'm getting ready to be called up to the front to speak. And I know it. And I see these people out there, people that you've heard of, out there, waiting for me to get up there. So I got this notebook, and I'm rattling through that notebook looking for something that really worked really well in my past. Like an ace in the hole, you know? I can't find it anywhere. I run through that way, and I run through my notebook that way, and nothing. There's nothing there. And I'm under the gun. Can't find them. Yeah. Translation for me is this. There's a new day. There's a new season. There's new things, a new profile, and a new wineskin. And old things of our past is not going to work with the race that's ahead of us currently. You guys from House of Prayer, you okay, good. Same race. Old things in the past, they were good things, but they're now become a weight. Same race, but different segment of the race. Sometimes, more than we know, God's about not just about enhancing what we got and who we are. He's about total renovation. You got that? He's about renovation. I'll end with this. Say hallelujah, amen. I could list a bunch more. But those are the ones that I deal with. And, you know, you share what you know. COVID. Well, when you say that word, it just carries weight. Doesn't it? It's weighty. Seriously, baby. COVID did a number on the church. It was real. We lost a precious, precious friend that caught COVID here in the church. Thankfully, I only know of one we lost. But boy, that was a big loss. And that was COVID. I continually hear over and over again when I sit down and have conversations with people, it comes up that how COVID affected and changed their lives. It's changed a lot of people's lives. Thoroughly believe that it was demonic in its origin. Only Satan could have thought of that kind of thing. I believe that spirits of fear took advantage of that. I believe there's residual effects that need to be broken off. I'm not saying that everyone needs that, but I think a lot of people do. I don't want to be negative here. But honestly, I don't think it's over yet. But I believe that our hearts can be prepared, better prepared now than it was when it was a surprise in February, March of 2020. Now, I'm not an anti-masker. I still put my mask on when I go into somebody, especially in Walmart and Thomasville, food line. I still do that. I'm not stupid. But there was a spiritual effect, I believe, that put a weight on God's people. Because I believe that the very target that Satan had, he hates human life. He hates it. He'll take it whatever chance he can get. But I believe the main target was the family of God in the earth. Because it did a number on us. And we're rebuilding. We're rebuilding. A lot of people are rebuilding. I look at a video of a church that I used to see, it'd be 1,000 people in there. There might have been 40 or 50 people in there. I'm telling you, I've said this over and over again. We're going to come out of this thing smarter, stronger, wiser, and more anointed than we went into it with. And anointing is coming for healing. For those kind of things. Boy, it's quiet in here. saying, what is it? What is this? Is it too hot? I won't ask for a show of hands, but I got a bookmark that I got. It says, put me in, coach. It's time for some of us to get back in the race. Not condemning. Not saying you shouldn't be careful. I'm just saying it's time to get back in the race. So this morning, I'm going to pray a prayer over this whole issue of this weightiness that the COVID put us in. Can I do that for you guys? Would you be willing to receive it? You're going to receive it sitting down? Ooh. Jesus, I bow to your lordship and your love. Maybe you should repeat this after me. What do you think? Jesus, I bow to your lordship and love. I stand in the authority you won for us and you have given us. Lord Jesus, if there is something in our minds or hearts, we come before you to deliver us and heal us. We submit ourselves to your shed blood, which forgives us, delivers us, and protects us. I repent for any fear that holds a place in me. You are Lord Most High, sovereign, in control. You have not given me a spirit of fear, but of love, power, and clear thinking. I cut off the spirit of fear, all of its assignments against me, all of its forms, they hold no power over me. I submit myself to the perfect love of God. I am yours, start to finish. Put me back in the race. I'm ready to run with you. Amen, amen, and amen. Let's give the Lord a hand. I'm finished.
I have something to say.
Heck, yeah, Christian.
All right.
Wait a minute. He's my friend.
It's really hard for me to speak right now, so I feel like I need to.
Wait a minute, Christian. I'm going to put you on.
It's really hard for me to speak right now because I'm nervous, but I know God is with me right now, and I need to say this. Right now when I was sitting there, my heart was racing, and maybe it's because I'm nervous for people's judgment, but I know I shouldn't be scared of anybody's judgment. And what I really want to say is that we have to start being bold and start going out and looking for these people that are broken. And this past week,
Well, yesterday, my brother, his name is Nicholas. We had went to Walmart, and he was like, he walked in, and he's my brother. He always picks me up when I'm down, and I pick him up when he's down. And I walked into Walmart, and he was like, "Hey, man, I have a feeling that I have to stand up, and I need to speak with everybody in here." And we walk in, and I'm just like, "Oh, you know, like it's that time. You know, we gotta release this fire with everybody." And I was really nervous. I really was. It was stuck in my head. I was really nervous to do it because I've never done something like that. But because he was willing to do it, I told myself, I was praying. I was like, why should I be scared? Why should I be afraid to do something God's will? Why should I be scared of that when he's not scared to leave me? And so, you know, I'm looking around, and he says he's about to use the bathroom, and I'm like, okay. I'm like, all right, that's cool, man. Go ahead, do your thing. And I'm over here talking to a friend of mine, and I'm over here waiting for him. I'm like, okay, we're gonna do this. I'm hyped about it now. My nerves are down, and I'm just like, all right, it's awesome. I'm like, we're gonna do it, and you know, regardless of what everybody thinks, somebody's gonna feed. We're gonna plant a seed on somebody, and somebody's gonna be able to receive the word. And so, we walk in, and I'm waiting on him, and then I turn around, and he's already doing his thing. He's already speaking. I'm like, oh. And I, you know, I start rushing over there, and I was, you know, about to be there with him and be part of it, you know. And I go, and I was nervous, but then for some reason my nerves were gone. Like it felt like everybody was there was just, you know, everybody was quiet. Some people were looking down. Some people were just looking at us weird. You know, some people were listening. Because, you know, it comes with it. You know, everything we do, we're going to receive judgment. We're going to receive hate, you know, and it just comes with it. And we, you know, he's talking, and then I'm with him, and he was getting, you know, kind of, like, nervous as well because, like, everybody there is just, like, looking at him weird. And but he doesn't care. He's like, I'm here, and I'm going to do what I need to do. And but I was there, and basically his fear went away when I was there as well, because, you know, when there's one, you can share so much, but when there's two, the word becomes stronger, you know, and the faith becomes stronger, and the leadership becomes stronger. So what I'm trying to say is that we got to start being bold and start going out and try to get everybody that's lost in this world and try to get them with God, because right now we're living in hard times, and God is coming, and the closer he gets, the worse it's going to get, and the only way to get everybody, to follow God and have faith with him is if we start coming out and leading these people that are lost to him, and the only way to do that is to be bold, and it's a hard thing, and it was a really hard thing for me to come out up here and because I was really nervous. I really was, you know. Yeah, but, you know, there's a lot of fear in this world, but the reality of it is that it comes, you know, it's part of the world, and it's gonna keep getting worse, and, you know, we have faith, and we have God with us, and end of the day, we shouldn't let the fear that the world creates define our fear. Our only fear is God, and for that, we should have grace for him as well. And I know that sometimes it is something that is, sometimes it's hard to comprehend, sometimes we get lost, and I know that from experience, but we need to be more bold and start going out here and speaking to these people that are lost, because a lot of people are in fear about a lot of things that are going on. They're confused. You know, they live in fear. They live in confusion. But we're the key to, you know, locking everybody's hearts and mind.
Man,
that was it.
That
That's amazing. This is Jose's nephew. So, yeah. He's been around here since he was about knee high to me. Used to get hugs from him all the time. Now he's gotten too old to give me hugs, I think. I don't know. We love that family. Yeah. God bless you guys. We love you. I love you. I respect you. Sometimes I'm amazed at the level of maturity we have at this place. I believe that we're a people that can carry a lot of weight when it comes time. And you guys are amazing. All right, I'll bless you. Father, in the name of Jesus, I bless everyone in this house right now. Pray for, Lord, protection. Pray for blessing, prosperity over each one. I pray for encounters of the Holy Spirit day after day after day. I ask for fresh revelation to come for the new race that is to be run. And I pray protection against any crime or any disease in Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. God bless you. Yeah.
Seasons will change, colors will fade, but I know that you remain. If the road changes course, my compass, your voice, and you will not leave me somewhere.